Hello and welcome to tonight's book reading session of Preparing for the Day After, a picture ebook. Preparing for the Day After is a photojournalistic treatise on disaster mitigation published by me, Malini Shankar, and Walter Keller for the 10th anniversary of the Asian tsunami. Tonight we will learn more about geological phenomena pertaining to the Asian tsunami, other tsunamis, etc. in this Part 2 of Chapter 12. But let us first recap what we have learned in the previous book reading sessions before starting tonight's session. Water and sanitation is central to developmental discourse. Culture-sensitive food security also has evolved out of local agrometeorological conditions prevalent in an area. Livelihoods based on local agrometeorological conditions are the best means of ensuring livelihood security. Climate change adaptation, menstrual hygiene, especially for indigenous tribal women, solid waste management, universal healthcare access, sustainable development goals, they are all factors to be included in the developmental agenda. Media personnel have to be trained in reporting disaster preparedness or the lack of it at district level. Disaster is the impact of a calamity on the human landscape. This includes the impact on lives, livelihoods, livestock, and landscape. Now, let's continue with tonight's reading on geological phenomena. I will be sharing a lot of travel anecdotes, including the harassment that I faced from the island administration for investigating corruption. Let's start with the box item, harassment of the author, that is me. Suffice it to say that the UT or the Union Territory Administration of Andaman Nicobar Islands would not give me any cooperation. They refused to prioritize my booking of accommodation. They refused to give me transport to travel around the islands. They refused to arrange for my travel to Trinket Island, to Indira Point and Barren Island Volcano. 6 letters in hard copy and 15 emails were ignored. Since I had not secured funding for the project, I was requesting for the good offices of the island administration, but without funding, the administration and the administrators thought that I was possibly free to sell my pictures, and none less than the lieutenant governor of the island administration asked me why I do need to shoot pictures if I have to do geological research. Well, in this chapter, I can prove why. They thought that without funding, I will make a profit by selling pictures. But let me tell you, viewers, on account of having secured technical collaboration with the Government of India and no funding at all, I tried to honor my commitment to the Government of India and the UN Photo Library, and I spent my own money to do the photography and research in various places, given that I had no funding. In Tamil Nadu and Pondicherry, my visit was facilitated by NGOs like MS Swaminathan Research Foundation and the NGO called Bedrock. But in Kerala, Odisha, Andaman Nicobar Islands, Himachal Pradesh, besides Sri Lanka, Indonesia and the Maldives, I had to spend my own money for photography, data mining and research and interviews. I am still struggling to recover the cost of book research. I can also share with you, my dear reader and viewer, that I have often overheard officers in Andaman Nicobar Islands conversing on the following lines, and I'm quoting them incognito here only because these two officers that I'm quoting are not relevant to this current narrative. One said, officer said, threaten him that we will abandon him in Campbell Bay. Another officer was overheard telling his colleague in Port Blair, he has admitted to his fault. Now you cannot condemn him to the gallows. During my field visit to the Nicobar Islands for photography and interviews, all islanders that I interviewed agreed that sinkholes have appeared rampantly in the islands, and authorities in the geologically volatile islands are not just callous but oblivious to the threat of sinkholes. Another Air Force officer who was posted in Khar Nicobar tells me that every time he visits Khar Nic, he sees sinkholes are widening. I quote him now, it is scary to go to the rim of the sinkholes for fear of being swallowed, unquote. Adding insult to injury, it is reliably learned that the Indian Air Force base in Khar Nicobar has documented the occurrence of a water spout in the pre-monsoon months of 2013. It has not been established if this water spout occurrence has been documented by the Disaster Management Authority of the Union Territory of Andaman Nicobar Islands, Phone calls, email requests for interview, and even a right to information application were ignored by the Directorate of Disaster Management Authority in the Andaman Nicobar Islands. The Indian Administrative Service officer heading the Disaster Management Authority was available in the Andaman Nicobar Islands only for 15 days of any month, given that her husband was working in Shanghai, China. Air Force officers who documented the event told the author, in Car Nicobar, that a water spout shot into the sky up to a height of about 1,200 meters. After my article was published in the Interpress News Service on sinkholes, the link of which will put up here as well as in the end of the in the description box below. One of my interviewees, Dr. Arun Bhapat, a seismological consultant, explained to me rather alarmingly that a water spout usually does not breach 20 to 30 feet in height. If it has shot up to 1,000 meters, it implies that it has been energized by nothing less than volcanic plume from the mantle or the lithosphere, that is the ocean floor. So can that mean that a whole new fresh volcanic island or a field is developing? Or could it be that a fresh mud volcanic field may erupt afresh in Car Nicobar? It surely calls for robust geological research. What if a whole new volcanic field emerges overnight in Car Nicobar or near any of the other Nicobar Islands, which has already suffered immensely in the Asian tsunami? All the officers and scientists I tried to interview admitted ignorance about sinkholes. The officers contacted by me for comments on sinkhole development in Nicobars included the National Geological Research Institute, Indian National Center for Ocean Information Services, National Institute for Ocean Technology, Deputy Commissioner of Nicobar Islands, Lieutenant Governor of Andaman Nicobar Islands, Secretary of Disaster Management Authority, and the Geological Survey of India. But attempts to contact were futile. Nothing concrete emerged by way of information. Given the lack of transparency in the administration, it is natural for officers then to feel intimidated by authentic research and competent researchers. RTI applications filed with the Directorate of Disaster Management Authority regarding occurrence of sinkholes did not even get a response. The Honorable Lieutenant Governor suggested to me to write articles on tourism potential of the islands instead. The UT, that is the Union Territories Directorate of Shipping Services, which used to ply ships to Barren Islands when it is active, has suspended the service to Barren Island. There are no helicopter services to the uninhabited Barren Island. So when I requested the Chief Secretary to facilitate helicopter ride to Barren Island to facilitate photography, I was advised to meet the Lieutenant Governor. I wanted to go to Barren Island for photography of an active volcano and also to check or photograph sinkhole occurrences in Barren Island. It took 4 written requests and advice from a former secretary to the Lieutenant Governor, an officer by name S.N. Mishra, that I should get my proposal vetted by Information and Publicity Secretary to meet the Lieutenant Governor. Now, the pertinent Information and Publicity Secretary was not capable of replying to my repeated requests on email, asking him to vet in writing my request to meet the constitutional head of the island administration was no more than harassment of a physically challenged woman journalist on assignment. And so the harassment of a physically challenged woman photojournalist went on till I wrote to the Honorable Lieutenant Governor on his personal email asking for an urgent appointment because of the seriousness of the sinkholes. I secured an appointment to meet the Lieutenant Governor and brief him, all right, but the Lieutenant Governor asked me why I wanted to do photography, if I wanted to do geological research. I admit I felt emotionally paralyzed and dumbfounded at his question. I had no choice but to record my experiences and protests in writing then. I showed him for pictures of sinkholes that I had shot in the various islands. I'm afraid he kept looking at his watch and minced no words in telling me that I was wasting his time. He, however, asked me to do my research and to document and tell him about the significance of sinkholes and voiced concern about the possibility of sensationalizing the issue. I have intimated the office of the Lieutenant Governor of Andaman Nicobar Islands by email, but it has not been acknowledged. Since no public transport by ship or helicopter service is available to visit Barren Islands, the ships were run by Department of Shipping Services whenever Barren Island was active. But during my visit in 2014, this service had been withdrawn. RTI application has not been replied as of mid-November 2014, and this book was published online on the 22nd of December 2014. However, a private tourism operator offers a 4-day package of visits to Barren Island, Neal Island and Havelock Island, etc. at the cost of 50,000 Indian rupees, or in 2014 conversion rates, it was about $809. Cynical islanders told me, "Don't you understand the obvious, madam?" Coming back to the geological phenomena, seawater ingress in many subsided parts of Nicobars has remained as cesspools. These inundated waters have refused to drain away a decade after the tsunami. Possibly at a future date, in an antithetic seismic uplift, the seawater inundation can drain. Not till then. Watershed management and ecological restoration of soil nutrition is the only means of disaster mitigation on livelihoods of native islanders. For millions of years, the Indian tectonic plate has drifted and moved in a north-northeastern direction. It has collided with the Eurasian tectonic plate and formed a series of mountain chains in the Pamir North, the Himalayan mountains being only one of them. As a result of such tectonic shift or migration and collision with both the Eurasian and the Australian tectonic plates, the Indian plate's eastern boundary as well as that of the Australian plate is a diffuse zone of seismicity and deformation, characterized by extensive faulting and numerous large earthquakes. The epicenters of both the 26th December 2004 mega earthquake and of the 28th March 2005 great earthquakes were near the Triple Point tectonic junction in the Indian Ocean, where major earthquakes and tsunamis have occurred in the past. According to the United States Geological Survey, the link of which is put up in the description box below as well as here under this visual, subsidence and landslides were observed in Sumatra. A mud volcano near Barathang, Andaman Islands became active on the 28th of December and gas emissions were reported in Arakan, Myanmar. Locals in Barathang too reported that natural gas emissions flared from the mud volcano in Barathang in Andamans. The mud flow has increased in the decades since the mega earthquake, according to locals. Susain Minj of Diglipur in North Andaman district told me, quote, "On the day of the mega earthquake, the mud volcano in Diglipur emitted natural gas flames, and in the decade since the tsunami, the mud flow is increasing." Yes. The Lusi mud volcano in East Java is, however, polemically so, a man-made disaster. An oil and natural gas extraction company in Indonesia started fracking for natural gas in East Java's Sido Oryo near Huanda in May 2006. As they pushed their pipes into the belly of Mother Earth, to their ill luck, a volcano erupted somewhere farther east in Indonesia simultaneously. Simultaneously, a mud volcano erupted in Huanda and spewed mud flow at the rate of 1,000 tons per day for about 18 months after it started the mud flow. It was tremendously hot, locals say. Within a 16-week period, villagers were submerged in the mud flow. The mud flow has continued to encroach more than 1,000 hectares ever since, destroying agriculture, homes, roads, industries in the surrounding area. A water spout flows out from the epicenter of the mud volcano and heads straight to the sea, according to Ms. Shirley Satyawati in Surabaya in East Java, Indonesia, a tourist guide who took me to the site for a photo shoot in December 2013. Since our December 2000 visit, however, a caldera has formed and the sinking of the mud flow seems to have commenced. People living in the houses even today suddenly experience cracks in their built homes and they see gas flames escaping out of such cracks, she added. Ms. Satyawati was also kind enough to conduct an interview in my behalf with the locals in the local language who are affected by the mud flow. Ms. Soni of the Rinoke Nongo village in East Java tells me in an exclusive email interview conducted with the good offices of Ms. Shirley Satyawati, quote, "The accident happened a night before 29th of May 2006 because of wrong drilling, and on the 29th of May, mud started flooding up the village. It has submerged all houses in hour in about 16 villages. The mud flow sunk my house too. I have lost my rice field too. It has affected my livelihood. Of course, it has also affected our water resources because most of the village people use well water and the air and water are polluted. Yes, the mud has affected the river. So many fish have died. The mud only affected the river around the location of the mud volcano. So it is okay for the river around Huanda. Yes, there are some river banks in its flood plain. Unquote. Mrs. Melpina of the Thanchulangin village in East Java in Thanchulangin Asri housing complex is one of the refugees of the mud volcano disaster. Says she, the mud flow is getting worse. So it has left villagers at the mercy of relief from the government and we have moved to shelters. The government supplies us food every day. As the groundwater is also extremely polluted, we depend on the government relief for water supply also. The first few months after the eruption, the air killed lots of trees in the surroundings. The continuous pollution has caused respiratory diseases in the refugees in Thanchulangin village shelters in Thanchulangin Asri, according to Mrs. Melpina. In the past 8 years, however, the mud flow has decreased substantially, and when I visited the mud volcano in East Java on the 9th of December 2013, the eruptions occurred once every 15 minutes. Other locals I met lamented that the compensation given by the government in the range of about 6,000 Indonesian rupiahs per person, which is about 50 cents of the US dollar, in about 200 houses are grossly inadequate. Attempts by me to contact the Indonesia's National Disaster Management Agency or the BNPB and the Volcanological Survey of Indonesia were largely futile, thanks mainly to the language barrier. Volcanological Survey of Indonesia's director apologized to me on cell phone chat WhatsApp for diffidence of not being able to grant me an interview because of the language barrier. I could not elicit replies on email from the director of BNPB or establish contact on telephone. An audio slideshow on BBC World Service website is cause for some cheer as a scientist shares that the mud flow should dissipate by 2017. Here's the link, it just came there. But I just checked with my sources in Huanda yesterday in Sido Oryo and I'm given to believe that the mud flow is continuing. That the Indonesian Disaster Mitigation Agency has installed more drain pipes to discharge the mud flow, but it is still oozing and destroying more and more area. In the month since my visit to Java Lucy mud volcano, a distinct crater or a caldera has formed as scientists had forecast. The collapse of the mud volcano is likely to occur under the weight of its own mud flow. Locals believe that at least the end is near and there is hope that life will get back to normal once fresh mud flow ceases. But then even if it were to cease in 2017 or 25 as originally envisaged, intensive soil conservation and restoration of soil nutrition besides watershed management are necessary to restore normalcy for sustenance of agriculture, fisheries or human activities. Now I will take you to another geological aftermath of the Asian tsunami. In the hours after the Asian tsunami hit Tamil Nadu, there were tremendous gusts of wind. Wind speeds from the ocean could have blown us away. We had to hold on to each other, such was the power of the gale, said Rupa Dawson Prabhu, survivor of the tsunami from Bangalore, who ran to safety and survived the tsunami in Velangini, Tamil Nadu. It is incredible to believe that the superfast waves of the tsunami with massive wavelengths can foster powerful winds. Such are the rational geological consequences of calamities. The Central Water Commission of the Government of India documented the occurrence of a freshwater spout in the middle Nicar Nicobar Island in the days following the Asian tsunami. This was also corroborated by islanders I met. Martin Luther, Paul Benjamin and Gabriel Simon of Car Nicobar Island, the district headquarters of the Nicobar Group of Islands, all experienced water spouts lashing their eyes during the tsunami. They ran to safety, still they experienced water spouts everywhere behaving like fountains or jet streams hitting their eyes. Paul Benjamin had to get his eyes cleaned in the Bishop John Richardson District General Hospital in Car Nicobar a few days after the tsunami. Quote, In the months following the mega earthquake, contaminated groundwater sources in both the Andaman and Nicobar Islands and along the mainland benefited from a particularly heavy monsoon season. Particularly heavy monsoon rains beginning in May helped to speed the recovery of groundwater, says the WHO report. Among the other geological highlights are the emission of natural gas in a mud volcano in Andamans. And geologists agree that it is the beginning of a long period of seismic ruptures of the Indian plate against the Eurasian plate at the Sunda 4 arc. Geologists agree that other great earthquakes will be triggered on the same fault line, either further north, northwest, or south-southeast of the epicenter of the Andaman-Sumatra mega earthquake. Some volcanoes erupted, defying forecasts that they were dormant. Tsunami scientist Dr. George Pararaskarayanis said there was a need to watch the Burney Thilong volcano in Sumatra. I have quoted this with written permission from Dr. George P. Karayanis, PhD. Volcanic hazards are looming in many parts of Indonesia. In Sumatra alone, Mounts Burney Thilong and Sulawesi Agam in Aceh, Mount Merapi in central Java, and Mount Sinabung in North Sumatra are considered among increasingly active volcanoes, says Dr. Tsukus Alves Yahrin, PhD, Tsunami and Disaster Mitigation Research Center Chief, Siakwala University, Banda Aceh, Indonesia, in an exclusive interview to me. Mount Sinabung, which was considered dormant for 400 years, roared back to life in 2010, leaving some to consider that its eruption was awakened by the mega earthquake, or at least because of the other great earthquakes on the west coast of Sumatra after the 26th of December 2004. You can see many pictures of the Mount Sinabung eruption on this link. I think it's coming up here, and it's also going to be put up in the description box below the video. Given that most of the active volcanoes in Indonesia belong to one of the greatest faults on Earth, the Sunda Fault, the volcanoes of Sinabung, Krakatau, Sulawesi Agam, Lake Toba, Mount Merapi, Mount Kelud, Mount Ijen, Tambora can be affected by seismic pressure accumulation as the Sunda Plate sits on a triple junction point. Indian plate thrusting in a north-northeastern direction, the Burma plate on the Eurasian plate is squeezed in a southwestern direction by the Australian plate, which is circling in an anti-clockwise rotation from the east. All of this leaves the Indonesian archipelago, consisting of 17,408 islands with a population of 27,69,91,161 as of 14th September 2021, at the receiving end of all the seismic pressure in the hemisphere. Consequences of these natural calamities include a wide, disparaging and slanted accumulation of development deficit. Some of the above-mentioned volcanoes have had an impact on microclimate in the near term, while Lake Toba supervolcanic eruption 74,000 years ago ushered in an ice age globally. Krakatau supervolcanic explosion in 1883 also created near-term climate change. On this link, on YouTube, you can watch a film made by Indonesia's National Disaster Management Agency on disaster preparedness for a volcanic explosion and industrial disasters in Krakatau area of West Java. It has English subtitles. Iceland's volcano management is a textbook example of disaster mitigation. Iceland's volcano management is a textbook example of disaster mitigation. Around the 19th of August 2014, 100 mild tremors were recorded around Bárðarbunga, alerting volcanologists, seismologists, and disaster managers in Iceland. To avert air traffic disruption, Iceland monitored the volcanic activity intensely for 10 days and the volcano erupted on the 29th of August 2014. The intense monitoring and constant alerts to the aviation industry has helped mitigate disruption in the aviation industry's busiest sector, the transatlantic flights. For more details, reading this website helps. Mount Kelud explosion in 2014 had seismic precursors, but there was hardly any time for evacuation as the mountain exploded before evacuation could be completed. 7 people died and over 100 people were injured according to the BNPB, that is the Indonesian National Disaster Mitigation Authority. Smithsonian Institution's Global Volcanism Program's activity report says, on the 13th of February 2014, the Indonesian National Board for Disaster Mitigation reported that a major eruption occurred at Kelud volcano in East Java, Indonesia. Ground-based observers had little insight about the ash plume height, but a number of satellite observations helped to constrain the height and other eruption parameters such as the direction of plume movement. Calypso satellite data revealed that a rapidly rising portion of the plume ejected material up to an altitude of about 26 kilometers well into the tropical stratosphere. Most of the less rapidly rising portions of the plume remained lower at 19 to 20 kilometers altitude. The 2014 eruption destroyed a dome emplaced in the volcano's caldera during the previous eruption in 2007. According to the BNPB, a report issued on the 18th of February 2014, around 7 people were killed and around 100,000 had evacuated. At least one commercial aircraft flew into the plume, later landing successfully but incurring costly engine damage. These are the forces of nature that cannot be prevented. Disaster preparedness calls for better understanding of causes and consequences and coping mechanisms. Big seismic events can trigger bigger volcanic activity. Krakatau, Mount Merapi, Tambora, Lake Toba, Santorini, Yellowstone, Mount Pinatubo all had volcanic explosivity index of more than 8, and these explosions have affected near-term climate change on a global scale. Lake Toba and Yellowstone had long-term climate change repercussions like extreme weather events, hydrometeorological disasters, avalanches, blizzards, cloudbursts, coastal incursions, cyclones, climate change, droughts, desertification. Epidemics, construed as an effect of climate change, floods, flash floods, famine, is a result of drought, forest fires, fog, hailstorms, landslides, mudslides, sandstorms, storm surge, storms, squalls, thunderstorms, tsunamis, and urban floods follow as consequences. However, nature retains her right of unpredictability. There has been a landslide in southwest China on the 27th of August 2014 in dry mud conditions or cold desert area. Point of emphasis here is a landslide has occurred without monsoons precipitating it. That's a BBC link. It's going to be put up again in the description box below. It does not mean that all earthquakes trigger volcanoes, or for that matter, all volcanoes are super volcanic eruptions. The perennially active volcanoes like Kilauea in Hawaii are hardly threatening, having more tourism-related significance. However, after 30 years of benign lava flows in November 2018, Kilauea in Hawaii rampaged human civilization. Secondly, perennially active volcanoes do not explode accumulated seismic energy. Kilauea became violent in 2018, but that's another issue. Says Dr. Tuku Alves-Yahrin, Tsunami Disaster Mitigation Research Center Chief, Siakawara University, Banda Aceh, Indonesia. In an exclusive email to me, he tells me, yes, the hazard of volcanoes is omnipotent in Sumatra. Bernitilong was the epicenter of the July 2013 earthquake. We have three volcanoes in Aceh itself. Sinabung is presently active, prompting residents to evacuate to shelters. Volcanoes are a constant hazard in Indonesia. The authorities monitor and manage the alerts for volcanic activities constantly. The alerts were sounded to B and then to A for Sulawesi Agam, as it is closest to Banda Aceh. We have to live with the fact that disasters are common where we live. It has nothing to do with someone being calm or not. For Indonesians, living with realities of seismicity and volcanism is a fact of life, but its repercussions should not be a fact of their lives. It is necessary to mitigate disaster risk because natural calamities have dire impacts on human life cycle. These calamities can decimate life and limb, livestock and livelihood of the common man. Indonesia, sitting as it does on a triple junction of tectonic plate, is particularly vulnerable to seismic and volcanic shocks, both of which can trigger tsunamis, and they have in the past. Supervolcanoes in Indonesia have triggered near-term and long-term climate change around the world. Geological calamities like earthquakes, volcanoes, and co-seismic activity are inevitable. But science can help us forecast these events and thereby plan better land usage as well as disaster mitigation efforts. Mitigating disaster risk is the responsibility of the administration with foolproof coordination. Here's a checklist. Installation of state-of-the-art early warning installations, dissemination of early warning, demarcation of evacuation routes with corresponding infrastructure support for mass evacuation at short notice, standardized temporary shelters with water and sanitation in direct proportion to population of vulnerable areas, infrastructure for mass cooking, medical preparedness infrastructure, transparent governance, maintenance of all infrastructure, standardized town planning without political interference. Geological calamities are inevitable, but better land use planning helps us avoid disasters emanating from bad planning. And that's all for tonight. With this, we have finished chapter 12 on geological phenomena. The next chapter is on water and sanitation in disaster-struck landscapes. Please do subscribe to our channel and share the videos in your circles and networks, because we need your support and encouragement to start a web series on disaster risk reduction. Please don't forget to tune in to the live interaction around 7:30 p.m. Indian time on Saturday evening, 18 September 2021. I hope to catch you during the live interaction. Until then, take care, keep smiling, stay safe, stay home. Ciao.